In part one of this series, I talked about the historical context and the reasons for the growing outcry for reparations for the descendants of enslaved people. Now let's look at the ask. Who are some of the primary advocates for reparations? What are they demanding, and what obstacles do they face? Notable black figures like Marcus Garvey and Malcolm X have called for reparations in the past, and Dr. Martin Luther King alluded to the idea of redress in his I Have a Dream speech when he said the following.
So we've come here today to dramatize the shameful condition. In a sense, we've come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. This note was a promise that all men, yes, black men as well as white men, would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It is obvious today that America has defaulted on this promissory note insofar as her citizens of color are concerned. Instead of honoring this sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has come back marked insufficient funds. But we refuse to believe that the Bank of Justice is bankrupt. We refuse to believe that there are insufficient funds in the great vaults of opportunity of this nation. So we've come to cash this check, a check that will give us upon demand the riches of freedom and the security of justice.
In 1989, former Congressman John Conyers of the United States introduced a bill to study reparations for black Americans. For 32 years, the bill, H.R. 40, never received enough support in Congress to be even considered for debate, until 2021. President Biden has indicated his support for the study. Representative Sheila Jackson Lee is now spearheading the cause. Other prominent black organizations and individuals in the United States have, at a minimum, supported conducting the study. The NAACP is also a supporter of the bill, as well as the Congressional Black Caucus. The National African American Reparations Commission, NAARC, a group of distinguished black intellectuals committed to fighting for reparations, has developed a 10-point plan. Beyond study, recognition, and apology as a starting point, there are those who are demanding more. Some advocates demand compensation in the form of government programs to meet the educational, social, cultural, and financial needs of affected communities and populations. Others demand compensation to help pay down or eliminate a country's debt. Some advocates demand monetary compensation to go directly to descendants of formerly enslaved people. One such example that has actually been successful is in Evanston, Illinois, a Chicago suburb in the United States. The city voted to fund reparations in the amount of $10 million over 10 years. Payments from the fund would be randomly awarded to qualifying black residents to pay for home repairs or down payments on property. The recipients would receive $25,000 each, and the fund would be paid for from a 3% sales tax on the sales of recreational marijuana. Robin Ruth Simmons, The city alderman who proposed the reparation describes it as a restorative housing program to address past anti-black housing policies. In June 2022, a California task force released its interim recommendations, laying out the case to address reparations and systemic racism for black Californians. They estimate that trillions of dollars will be needed to eliminate the wealth gap. For many advocates of reparations, the various demands are not mutually exclusive. For example, the 15-member CARICOM nations made up of Caribbean countries endorsed a 10-point reparations plan in 2014. The high-level plan proposes a variety of remedies, including a full apology, debt cancellation, and programs to address education and healthcare, among others. The plan goes beyond demanding reparations for the descendants of slavery and includes support for indigenous communities, such as descendants of the Kalinagos, that was systematically brutalized, dispersed, or eradicated under European rule in those Caribbean countries.
That when we speak about reparations and the conversation that we have about reparations, we are not just speaking about a check that we are asking the former colonial powers to write a check of X amount, a million of dollars and so on. No. The 10-point CARICOM plan encompasses different areas. It's a developmental program, frankly. So it begins with a full apology from the colonial powers. That's the first thing on the CARICOM 10-point plan. A full apology. Then you have issues with regards to investment in our health sector, illiteracy eradication, debt cancellation, empowerment of our indigenous communities, because you know the Kalinago people, the first inhabitants of the Caribbean region, they suffered genocide on the hands of the European colonizers and so on. So the 10-point CARICOM plan encompassing a wide area of really of a developmental program to assist the Caribbean with regards to development.
We've been arguing this for over 20 years, and the CARICOM Reparatory Commission has basically set out a 10-point plan of the different things that they believe need to be done, starting, of course, with an apology, but also dealing with things such as the psychological rehabilitation as a result of the trauma, dealing with assistance in remedying the public health crisis. Most people don't even recall that the diets of slaves were heavily salted and in many instances have led to the kind of intergenerational hypertension and diabetes and chronic non-communicable diseases that we see. And then in respect of the debt, Caribbean governments at the point of independence, there was no development compact to say, look, this is what you need to go forward. But what they did was to try to reverse the negative aspects of colonialism, which meant dealing with housing, which meant dealing with right to education, right to healthcare, all of the basic things that normal governments would want to see as part, in fact, of the sustainable development goals today that the United Nations has set up. Now, I said to you that this was started about 20 years ago, largely because in December 2000, I was then Minister of Culture and Education. I would have been the one leading the Barbados delegation to the UN World Conference Against Racism, Xenophobia, and Racial Discrimination. And that was one of the preparatory conferences that took place before we went to Durban in August, September 2001 for the World Conference. In between there, we would have had a number of meetings in Geneva across the world. In fact, I remember it well because it was the same week that the German government agreed to give compensation to those who were affected by the awful Holocaust of World War II. So that this is not a new concept. What I want to say, and I think Prince Harry captured it, there has to be a conversation. It can't be reduced to a headline. It can't be reduced to sensationalizing. And to that extent, therefore, we expect that the conversation, difficult as it may be, is absolutely necessary. The English-speaking Caribbean is perhaps one of the most highly indebted regions in the entire world, with debt-to-GDP ratios way above many other countries. And of course, now that we've gone into the COVID pandemic, it's become exceptionally difficult for a lot of these countries to be able to raise money on their own because of the high debt burden that they carry, not because of any wickedness, but already because they want to be able to put in place a development compact for their people that was not given to their people prior to independence, and the resources were not left for us to do so in a way that the compensation took place at emancipation.
So this,
and Europe was a member.
This conversation, as you say, or this was initially brought up about 20 years ago. We know that Tony Blair, when he was Prime Minister in 2007, did publicly apologise, didn't he? He apologised for Britain's role in the transatlantic slave trade. That's 13 years ago now. Do you feel like, even though we're having this conversation today, that actually the conversation and the tone and what's being talked about has shifted at all in that time? Or do you still feel like 20 years ago when this was started, you haven't got anywhere? Because you're talking about an apology, and clearly Tony Blair has made an apology.
And I believe others across the world have apologized, but that's the first step.
Yeah.
I think we need to be able to understand that the underdevelopment of Africa, the underdevelopment of the Caribbean, the underdevelopment of Latin America, in many instances, is a child of the colonial experiment. And the colonial experiment extracted wealth. And in some of these countries, the extractive attitudes still remain, such that we've not been able to build the kind of domestic enterprises and the domestic foundation that's necessary to sustain our people. And the biggest problem, more often than not, is mental too. We've removed the legal vestiges to discrimination in many instances, but it is the mental emancipation. Bob Marley popularized the words of Marcus Garvey. It is the mental emancipation. It's the use of things like blacklisting of Caribbean countries, or it's the use of and other countries for tax or other purposes. It's this kind of language that associates negative with black and positive with white. And then when you start to look at the difficulties in the United States of America with respect to policing and access into basic services, or what it takes to have persons struck from voters' lists, all of these are things that deprive ordinary people from the promise of development that should be all of ours. And I think that we have a set of people across the world now with a level of consciousness, particularly young people, who are recognizing that this existential threat called the climate crisis is causing us to really understand where we stand. And as if that were not enough, then comes the pandemic that teaches us the worth of jobs, the worth of family, the worth of the environment, the worth of everything around us. And it's a resetting that perhaps we couldn't time the two. And that resetting, I think, has given us the sensitivity that, you know, maybe we need to have this discussion. Now people talk much easier today about mental health.
Once the idea of money or compensation, to right a wrong, is introduced to almost any human interaction, then the factors of fairness, blame, denial, proportion, greed, guilt, entitlement, fear, shame, qualification, and even revenge immediately come to the forefront. Reparations for the descendants of enslaved people is further complicated by the fact that the original victims are no longer alive. Their descendants, 5 to 8 generations removed, depending on when slavery was abolished in a particular country, are widely dispersed geographically, considerably divided politically, and almost irreconcilably mixed up with other ethnicities, including that of the racial group that was responsible for slavery. Also, there is no firm consensus on the topic amongst blacks. There are those who would be satisfied with acknowledgement and a formal apology for the wrongs that were done. Others would prefer to see the enactment and enforcement of new and existing policies and legislation to address the continued discriminations and inequalities that exist. Yet still others demand compensation as an end goal to address past and current injustices, financial and social inequalities, and even promises that were made but never kept. For example, 40 acres and a mule. In some cases, one demand has been peripherally addressed, although not to the satisfaction of most advocates of reparations. Words and phrases have been carefully chosen to avoid uttering the word apology, as the latter may be understood to be an acceptance of guilt, and consequently may lead to financial, social, and political responsibilities. In 2001, Britain, Spain, Portugal, and the Netherlands blocked the European Union from issuing an apology for slavery, pushing instead for an expression of quote-unquote regret for the slave trade. Earlier this year, on a visit to Jamaica, Britain's Prince William said that while reparations are not part of the government's approach, we feel deep sorrow for the transatlantic slave trade and fully recognize the strong sense of injustice and the legacy of slavery in the most affected parts of the world. We also believe that we have much to do today and in the future to address the reality of slavery in the UK and around the world. In 2015, then British Prime Minister David Cameron told Jamaica to move on from the discussion of reparations. On a visit to Senegal, Portuguese President Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa said Portugal recognized the injustice of slavery. However, he did not offer an apology. U.S. Senator Mitch McConnell called slavery America's original sin, but argued the country has since made racial progress and strides towards rectifying the past, including passing civil rights legislation and electing Barack Obama. He also said that slavery was abolished so long ago that no one currently alive was responsible. In 2008, former U.S. President Barack Obama recognized the continued legacy of slavery, but did not necessarily support reparations. Instead, he favored more practical policy goals. In an August 2008 NAACP questionnaire, he responded, "I fear that reparations would be an excuse for some to say we've paid our debt and to avoid the much harder work of enforcing our anti-discrimination laws in employment and housing. The much harder work of making sure that our schools are not separate and unequal. The much harder work of providing job training programs and rehabilitating young men coming out of prison every year. And the much harder work of lifting 37 million Americans of all races out of poverty. The challenges will not go away with reparations. So while I applaud and agree with the underlying sentiment of recognizing the continued legacy of slavery, I would prefer to focus on the issues that will directly address these problems and build in a consensus to do just that." U.S. Representative Burgess Owens believed that reparations are impractical, unfair, and heartless, since it will give people a false sense of hope that it could become a reality, given the complications of implementation and strong public resistance generally. Although most reparation advocates see a bold line between blacks and whites in terms of wealth and health resulting from slavery and continued inequalities in society, many people do not see or acknowledge a direct correlation. Some see a dotted line rather than a bold line, while others see no line at all. The obstacles are, of course, daunting. For most, their opposition to reparations comes down to money. Why should their tax dollars be used to compensate blacks for the ills of the past? They argue that many whites did not own enslaved people or otherwise benefited from the slavery economy, or the post-slavery programs such as FHA loans, the GI Bill, and educational opportunities to top schools. During slavery, some groups, like the Quakers and other abolitionist groups, were fierce opponents of slavery. Many whites suffer from the same diseases such as diabetes and hypertension that are predominant in the black population. In the early post-slavery era, poor whites and European immigrants in the U.S. normally lived in communities separated from blacks and endured some measure of discrimination and abuse. Several studies have shown that the poor in the Appalachian communities of America suffer similar medical disparities such as high infant mortality and cardiovascular diseases as blacks elsewhere in the country. In Brazil, right-wing activists aligned with the agro industry have waged sustained opposition, including violence and murder, against Quilombo inhabitants. They argue that the awarded land titles included some lands that were already owned by others, or were awarded based on individual claims that were not thoroughly vetted. Still others blame the lack of advancement on the dependency on government safety net programs meant to help struggling families. Then there are those who argue that the disparities can be attributed to the blacks themselves. They blame the problems on corruption by black rulers in certain countries, and the general ineptitude and laziness as a trait common to blacks. Of course, the latter is just a racist trope. Of course, the counter-argument is that slavery was not just an individual endeavor. It was supported and enforced by government policies. Also, what is not always acknowledged by critics of reparations is that government safety net programs in America are utilized by more whites than blacks. Furthermore, tax dollars have always been used on behalf of the public to pay for things that we may or may not support or even benefit from individually. For example, pensions for government workers, waging wars, or subsidizing farmers.
I refuse to give the Negro any land. Through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
Polls show that advocates for reparations face an uphill battle. A June 2020 Reuters poll found just one out of every five Americans support the idea of taxpayer money to pay damages to descendants of enslaved people in the United States, with around 10% of white people in support compared to about half of black respondents. A 2021 University of Massachusetts poll found 62% of respondents opposed reparations. Nearly 86% of African Americans support the idea, while only 28% of whites do.
So there is a buzz in the community, in the gradient society, with regards to the issue of reparations. I think that persons are more aware of the issue of reparations now than they were 2 years, 3 years ago. But I think that there's a lot of work still that we need to do to raise the level of consciousness of our people with regards to the issue of reparations. So there is support. There is support, but I think we are not yet where we really want to be.
Five times great grandfather was a slave owner.
Here.
In Grenada.
And then, when slavery was abolished, in 1834, my family received the equivalent of £3 million in compensation, and the slaves received nothing. Do you think that my family should pay money in reparations to the people of Grenada.
There are a variety of reasons why so many people oppose reparations. Some do not see it as a genuine attempt to address the injustices of the past, but merely as a means to get money from wealthy nations. They point to the fact that some African countries and former enslaved people were complicit in the slave trade. For example, some African communities traded their captives from neighboring communities with European slave traders in exchange for weapons and other sundries. The Maroons of Jamaica were forced into agreements with the British to capture and return runaway slaves in return for peaceably existing in their communities without British hostilities. Arabs were involved in slave trading long before the Atlantic slave trade began. Their markets were primarily the Middle East, the Mediterranean, and Indian subcontinent. Some African nations like Ghana have apologized for their role in slavery. Benin also apologized for the treaty it signed with Portugal to capture and export enslaved people in the 15th century. However, critics of reparations point out that these groups and nations have never really been sufficiently called out by advocates who demand reparations. To counterbalance these arguments, one can cite the fact that British enslavers and corporations were compensated for the loss of their enslaved people, while the enslaved people themselves were left to fend on their own. For the Maroons, the agreement with the British must have been a simple calculation: return the runaways or face continued British attacks on their remote communities. For the African groups that traded their captives, it was most likely a convenient and probably lucrative means of ridding themselves of captives from wars and raids on neighboring communities and villages without knowing the fate that awaited those captives. Though not entirely comparable, there are still vestiges of this practice of trading human beings today. One can look at some revolutionary groups and even some nations that capture and imprison foreigners and later exchange them for money or their own fellow countrymen. Of course, none of this excuses the practice of trading human lives for profit or safety. Other challenges for the advocates of reparations include determining who is eligible and the amount of the compensation. How do you go about calculating what a reasonable compensation should be? Should it be based on current financial, educational, and social needs? Current disparities in black and white per capita income? The value of enslaved people adjusted to today's economy? Or the compensation that was paid to the owners of enslaved people adjusted to today's economy? In the 1970s, Yale law professor Boris Bittaker arrived at a sum of $34 billion based on per capita income. In 2003, former Haitian president Jean-Bertrand Aristide demanded over $21.6 billion in reparations from France to make up for the lost opportunity to invest in Haiti's infrastructure as a result of France's earlier extortion to recognize the island's independence. The claim was never seriously considered. In 2010, the French government rejected a petition to pay Haiti $17 billion in reparations to aid in reconstruction after a devastating earthquake. The rejection was based on the fact that the government was already providing Haiti with substantial support and will continue to do so in the future. In 2020, Professors William Darity and Kristen Mullen argued that compensation should be based on census records, genealogy, and a projection of the worth today of 20 acres and a mule. These examples highlight the need to study the best way to move forward and develop plans appropriate to the needs of each country or region. That is the governing principle behind both H.R. 40 bill and the 10-point CARICOM plan. The Determining how to move forward presents a minefield for the advocates for reparations. The polls are not very encouraging, and the hard work of determining eligibility and compensation still lies ahead. However, the drumbeat continues to grow louder, and there is some reason for optimism for the advocates. Some institutions like Harvard and Lloyd's of London are instituting programs to address their past involvement in slavery. And the recent success of the town of Evanston, Illinois, to offer limited and specific reparations to its constituents offers a novel path forward. Even for many who oppose reparations, the idea that slave owners were compensated and not their enslaved people, or that other groups have been compensated for the evils they endured, but not blacks who suffered longer, goes to the heart of fairness and equity that they must reconcile internally.